Go. Go. Ready?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Are we on?
No. So he was doing that because he saw this, and so he tried to turn it up so he everybody could see my turkey gobbler. I don't care. I just don't care.
It's okay, Tiny. You're recorded. You're out.
You better not be recording me right now.
Too we late. Sure are.
Oh, great.
Guest appearance. Guest appearance.
Here, I'm going to put this chair right here for Rick.
Yeah.
Can you get in a little bit, Eric, or no?
Wow.
Okay, there we go.
This is epic. Coach Erik Paulson, okay, Coach Tanya Paulson.
Well, honey, stop.
Coach Rick Young isn't on camera yet, but he's here.
Okay, hold on. Let me see if I sit right here. You can see me.
Yes, I can see that chair. Yes. Where is Coach Rick?
He's in the bathroom.
Oh, okay.
Turn it back just a little bit this way, Eric. Okay.
I'm leaving all of this in. Where are you going? Don't leave.
I'm going to.
See, that's cool. What does that symbol mean?
It's called the San Benedicto, Saint Benedict cross, which is the most powerful cross that they use during exorcism to ward off all evil and demonic presence.
Coach Rick.
Hi.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Rick Young, straight from Edinburgh, Scotland, to Los Angeles to here. Officially,
Rick, did you have
the- here now is Rick. What's your middle name?
Richard William Hogg Young.
Richard William Hogg Young.
Yeah.
But it sounds better when he says it.
I was always ashamed. Are we, is this?
We're on.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You don't have to be formal though, Coach.
I was always ashamed of my middle name, Hogg, because like a pig. But then I spoke to someone.
It's not Hogg, it's Hogg. H-A-U.
No, H-O-G-G.
H-O-G-G.
So, but Hogg, I found out in Scottish, you know, and Celtic means, not Celtic, but Scottish, Old Scots means warrior. So my dad gave that to me as a, you know, as a pass on, you know. So I was always ashamed of it until I found out. And I thought, oh, that's great, you know. That's really nice.
That's,
you know, so
very fitting.
Ironic. How would he have known that you would have turned out the way you did?
I think he would have been really disappointed.
What? Not true. Not true. No, one of the most respected martial artists in the world. You got two of them sitting right next to each other right there.
8-time world jiu-jitsu champion. And he's the top Niwaza guy in all of the UK.
No.
Yes. No. He says he's not, but he is.
He's just a little bit humble.
Very humble, but that's great. I would like to state that when I got sick, Rick showed up, and right away he flew in from Brazil. He was in Brazil training when he heard I was sick, and he came in and he said, I'm going to come and read to you. And I was like, and I was in a hospital bed. I was on my fourth room. This was my last room of healing. It was supposed to be my, I don't know, healing room. Wasn't very big, and Rick came in, sat underneath the vent, and the cold air was beating on him, and he sat and read to me for almost, well, close to 8 hours, and he said, I have three things to read to you. He goes, I have the old man in the sea, I have dirty jokes, or...
That's right, I forgot about the dirty jokes.
Or the Bible.
I forgot
and the dirty jokes. I was in such... pain that I found no comedy in anything. So I said, I don't want any jokes right now because I'm not going to laugh. But I've never heard Old Man in the Sea. So Rick started reading The Old Man in the Sea. And then he started reading some scriptures to me. And it was interesting because every time he started reading, I would drift off into a nice, hollow, snory sleep. And someone said, how come every time he's reading, you're falling asleep? I go, it's like I'm getting the Bible dictated by Sean Connery. Because his accent was so peaceful and humble. And when I heard him, I was just drifting off to sleep.
That's funny.
And I was, I had dreams of running across the mountainside in Norway with these cool blue shoes that I had. And I was obviously hallucinating off of the, well, they were getting towards the end. It was something called Dilaudid. It was one of the most powerful. I know ketamine is very powerful, but the one they gave me was Dilaudid. That thing makes you hallucinate. And the doctors were using me as an experiment. They're like, tell us a little bit about your dreams. And I was like, well, my eyes are open and I'm not even dreaming. And I'm still having visions of big goldfish floating in and out of people. Wow. One day I was on a spaceship and Corey walked in, my sister, and I go, shh. She goes, what? I go, we're in a spaceship. There's honeycombs all around us. And
you're tripping.
Well, yeah. And then there was a night when I did have a visitation in my dream. I don't know if I was hallucinating. I probably was. But I had extraterrestrials come, and they weren't very nice. And then I tried to get in a fight with one of them, and I grabbed him, and he became super strong, and he looked like GSP almost. And then he had these two little things come out the side of his head. And I go, holy crap, I can't fight this guy. This guy's too strong. And then all of a sudden I listened to him, and they just tried to tell me that everything I was going through was fake. They go, it's all fake. This isn't real.
Well,
and they came. I saw them 2 days, but then the dream of running down the mountain was really cool. Running down the mountainside, I actually was in Norway, and there was a water, and then there was like a granite cliff, and I was running along the granite cliff and coasting across the water. And the reason I was having that one was because I was having in and out of body experiences, because I had this neck brace on, and I was actually hallucinating, and I was having panic attacks in my sleep so bad that I was actually going in and out of my body. So I woke up one morning and I yelled for Tanya because I thought I had a dream that we both died, and I wasn't sure if we're dead. So I yelled, and she sat up and she hit her head on the table. And then she sat up, and I go, Tanya. She goes, what? I go, are we alive? Mm-hmm. I go, are you alive? And I go like this. And I just to reach out, just because I thought she was holographic. And she was 100%. Yeah, I slapped her.
Slapped the crap out of me.
Not on purpose, though. I was afraid we were dead.
I clanked my teeth together.
I really thought we were dead. I mean, I had gone in and out of my body. I was in this one room for 18 hours. I was in this one room, and I was going in and out of consciousness. And I told the guy, the nurse came in, and I asked him, I go, how do I do this? And he goes, what? I go, I'm not sleeping in the night. And he goes, you got to force yourself to stay awake all day long. He goes, you can't nap in the day. He goes, then you'll have peaceful sleep. And with the amount of medication they were giving me, I couldn't help but fall asleep. And then you got Sean Connery reading me the Bible. I was like, you know, an old man in the sea. We didn't even finish it. He's going to.
It's not just Eric. It's a common theme. When I start talking, people fall asleep.
No.
I just bore people to sleep.
And then you take your arm from around their neck.
I think they're trying to understand. His English is much better now than it was before.
Someone asked me if I speak English.
Yeah, what language
do you speak? It was earlier on in the week when I just arrived in LA. He said, do you speak English? Sometimes, you know. Wow. I'm trying to learn Portuguese, you know, but yeah, I speak a lot of English, you know.
Why are you learning Portuguese aside from the fact that you're going to Brazil regularly?
I like Brazil, and I'd rather not talk about that too much.
Rick's been going to Brazil a lot and training, yeah. And it's really good and cool because he loves the culture over there, and it's pretty
awesome.
Neat.
My instructor Mauricio Gomez, he said to me, I've been to Brazil over 20 times and I don't speak Portuguese, and we were talking.
Are you embarrassed though that you don't speak?
Well, yes, I am. And I said to him, and I remember I was in Rio, and I'm with Mauricio, who's an 8th degree, you know, Corral belt. I'm with
Mauricio is Roger's dad. Roger
Luciano, Luciano, who's like an 8th degree, and I'm with Zeta Xira, who's now I think a 6th, 7th degree. So I'm with these guys in Rio, these masters, and they're all talking English for me. And it just hit me. I thought, I feel really embarrassed that after all these trips, I haven't picked up any Portuguese. So there's other reasons too, but that's kind of why I thought, you know, I really should learn Portuguese, you know, so that I can at least kind of pick up on some of the things they're saying, you know, and pick up some of the detail a little bit more, you know, and I think, and just to show a little bit of respect for the art. But I should have done that with Filipino too, to be honest, you know, with the and Filipino arts. But anyway, I'm trying now. So I speak a little bit of English, un poco English, and un poco Portuguese.
You know, it's, going to Japan also, it's embarrassing that I wasn't fully affluent in Japanese. I was there 42 times.
At least 42 times?
Yeah, 42 times. But I've been there so many times that I could start to understand. Like, as soon as I get there, I kind of understand what they're saying.
Wow.
And so I couldn't carry a conversation, but I could understand what they were saying. Ooh. And the same thing when I started going to Germany. I studied German in elementary and junior high, and I could understand what they were saying. And I always pretend like I didn't know what they were saying. Until I was in a room and they were carrying on a conversation. They were talking about firing somebody. Yeah. And I go, you guys shouldn't fire him. You should talk to him first. And they were like,
yeah. You outed yourself.
They're like, oh, you understand German. I go, well, what are you talking about? I don't, you sprechen Sie Deutsch? I go, I don't sprechen Sie Deutsch. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
How do you say understand? I understand in Sie Deutsch.
I don't know.
Hey, Coach, can you tilt your monitor down just a little bit? Just slightly? There you go. That's better. Thank you. I can see you guys better now.
All right.
Awesome.
Yeah, so it is embarrassing going all over the place and not really speaking the language. Same with going to Italy.
That's hard.
Rick, where else do you go? Poland?
Yeah, I think the problem is people, as you know, English is international. So if I learned Polish, it wouldn't transfer to Spanish, or if I learned Spanish, it wouldn't transfer to Deutsch very much.
But,
you know?
But Spanish and Portuguese.
Those two link in well. Spanish, Portuguese, Italian. I just got back from Italy and they kind of link in. The same thing I kind of understood a little bit. But I think for me anyway, for speaking from Scottish perspective, you know, that we're kind of lazy in a lot of ways that we think, well, English is international, so everybody will speak English. So rather than learning, you know, a language, you know, it's not really necessary, which I think now is wrong. I think now I tell my kids, you know, I tell my children, you know, that they should learn the language for sure. And especially for us, I think because we're doing martial arts, you know, that, you know, learning Portuguese right now, trying to learn a little bit of English too, then it's important. Good for our brain too.
Well, I also think that we should teach the universal language of love.
We spread that every day.
I was going to lean over and give Eric a kiss. But I thought,
you should do it. That'll be the poster for the podcast.
I did take the ball. I dropped it.
I just made it. So I have a fresh coconut in my fridge. And anytime you're feeling sick, or if you're hungover, or if you're dehydrated, if you feel like you're about to get really sick, just cut that top off and drink the coconut water. Immediately rehydrates you and gives you all, you know, it's weird. Like, of all the things you can drink, I think the coconut,
it's very nice.
Yeah, the coconut water out of a fresh coconut is probably some of the best stuff you could drink for rehydration.
I've never done that, like right out of a coconut.
Oh, and then you eat the meat out of it. It's so good.
I love coconut. That's awesome.
do a lot of that in Brazil, right?
Yeah. Beach, yeah. I love coconuts. They're great, but they drive you nuts.
I have a real quick question for Rick. So you mentioned Old Scottish briefly earlier. Is there actually, is it not Gaelic? Like, is it an actual?
Celtic.
Celtic? Is that different than Gaelic?
I think, I may be wrong, right? I'll probably get picked up by someone on this, but I think Gaelic is more kind of going toward the Irish as well. But I think Celtic is ours. It used to be, I think, one sort of main language, you know, that was spoken, you know, kind of between Irish, Scots, you know, the fix. But I'm not 100% sure, to be honest. But we have a Gaelic channel in Scotland. There's a channel, Gaelic. I don't understand a word of it, to be honest with you.
I'll tell you, I was on a seminar with Rick and with Guro, and there's 150 people there, and I had guys walking up to me, and they were speaking to me. And this guy, I looked at him, I go, "What language are you speaking?" And he goes, "English." And I go, "Where are you from?" Was he Northern Scottish? From the north? Or
is
what?
It thicker up north? Oh,
you cannot even understand him.
Ireland's like that too. Down in the south, they speak so fast. Like, it's like, whoa, what is that? I can't follow. And the slang, a lot of slang.
Remember
I don't remember the particular one, but I know that, I think the thing, even between Edinburgh and Glasgow, you can tell that's 40 miles between, huge difference in the way we speak, you know, and some of the words, if you hear someone saying something from a certain word, you go, "He's from Edinburgh," or just the way they speak. And then if you go up to Aberdeen, but 100 miles different as well, yeah. Wow. So I mean, you can tell right away.
Can you tell the difference?
100%.
You know where they're from?
Yeah, you can tell. Yeah,
it's like
yeah.
America. We know if someone's
from
New York or, you know, wherever.
Baltimore.
Yeah. So
doesn't Baltimore.
Okay, hon.
Don't they have an accent there in Baltimore?
Oh, you can pick out a Maryland person very easily. Yeah.
Really?
Okay, hon. It's a really unique accent.
We don't even understand what you're saying.
It was his hon.
Wow.
Like even different parts of the state, it's different. I grew up closer to D.C. and then moved up to Baltimore later, but it's this a really unique accent. There she is. Why don't you stay with us, Tanya?
I'm working.
You're just doing guest appearances. You're photobombing the podcast.
Wave.
There's the queen. She's the one who makes it all happen.
Shush, shush. I'm just working away like a busy little bee.
So Alan's on the road today. I'm not sure if he's going to be able to jump in. He just got my message. He might jump in from his phone or something if he gets a second. He's traveling.
So wait, did he drive to LeVon's?
Yeah. Yeah, so he's on the road.
Guro's going to LeVon's this weekend?
Is he? Is Guro going to be at LeVon's?
Oh, wait, I thought.
Is it Lee Peacock?
No, is he at Lee Peacock's? Where is he?
I don't know. I don't know where he is this weekend.
Florida. He's in Florida.
Okay. Okay, cool.
So that's probably Lee.
Could be.
I think it's Lee, yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, just saw him 2 weeks ago. He's great.
I'm just wondering how people get their last names. Right? Because he's always young. He looks young. Every time you see him, he looks younger.
I wish.
Well, now that I know Hogg is a warrior.
Yeah. That's right.
That's awesome. That still blows my mind. How would he have known? He really is a warrior.
Yeah, but,
well, we have to ask, do you love truffles? Yes or no?
Oh, for sure.
Okay. It could go either way then. You just don't know.
So what have you been doing since you got out to L.A., Coach Rick?
What I do, I'm trying to think.
You hanging out with Guro Dan a lot?
On Monday night, yeah. Spent Tuesday. Saw Guro Dan Tuesday morning. I went dropped by the academy. He was getting his Cambodian kickboxing lesson. Mm. Which was great. You know, it was great to watch.
He's sparring with his coach.
Yeah.
Like,
really?
Straight.
Yeah.
And amazing. Then he videotapes it and he watches it.
It's amazing. Yeah. It's really amazing to watch him do that. And
83.
Then, he's a stud.
83 years young and he's still sparring with his Cambodian, trying to figure things out. Isn't that funny?
It's incredible. Yeah. It's incredible. And then we had a meal together in the afternoon. Coach Erik came over, Tanya, and we had a meal, and then I trained at night in the classes at night at the academy.
How was that that night?
Nice. It was really nice. Really cool. You know, cool. really nice. Really great. And for me, it's just great to be around girl. You know, I like everybody else. I know that. Yeah. And it's just great to be around them. And, you know, I don't know. It's just such a unique human being. We're all unique, but he's something else. Right. And on the Wednesday, what we do on the Wednesday, I watched the kids class. I was there for the kids class. Went out for a meal with him after, which was great. You know, had a nice meal with him. And then yesterday, had the morning class, which I love. I love the Cali class, the 10:30 class, Thursday morning. It's just nice, relaxed class. Guro's great. Damon Kiro was there.
Oh.
Daniel Nero, you know, so it was really nice. You know, had a nice night, really nice chilled time. And then afterwards, Guro gets a lesson from Kenny Johnston. So I went to that. The wrestler, and he just about fell too, the wrestler, and he gave a really nice lesson.
Did you say guy's black belt?
I'm sorry?
What did you say?
He's a black belt too, yeah?
He is?
Yeah, I got a black belt from Cabrina. Yeah.
Oh, he did? Wow. Yeah. That's good.
So that was great. And then Guro took the kids class, and then I went back later and then took the classes, and it was wonderful. Yeah, really great. Just a really great time. Now I'm here with my coach, Sensei. Yeah. So, friend. It was coach.
Friend.
And it was just really nice. You know, I think coming here, because now you can come for short periods of time, but it's just great. It's great to see everybody, see Guro. It was a lovely meal and another afternoon, right? It was really cool.
Were you able to get on the mat and roll it all this time? Or
no. I'm going to go down, I think, tomorrow. I'm going to go with Damon to see... Craig Husband, yeah.
What's his
Craig,
name?
I think it's Craig Husband. I may be getting that wrong, Craig. So tomorrow we're going to do that. And then it's kind of like nice to relax a little bit, do some training, relax. So it's not full on, you know, like it used to be totally full on.
He's training every day. He's just not training day and night.
Well, that's true. That's a really good point. That's an excellent point because somebody... I said to someone one time, I said, yeah, I didn't really train that hard that trip. And they went, oh, so you're not training very much. And I went, well, wait there. And I went, one day I trained 6 hours. Another day I trained 5.
Yeah.
I trained
four. It's not very hard.
And the least I trained was 4 hours. And then I went, actually, you know, that's actually quite a lot. And because before, Coach Erik will tell you, when you came over, everything was like boom, 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 boom. Like literally from 6 in the morning. I remember one trip, I was meeting Guro at 6 in the morning at the academy.
And Mark McFan, too.
Mark McFan, yeah, that's true.
You were meeting him earlier that I couldn't even get up. I was like, these guys are leaving the gym when I'm walking in.
No, no, yeah, that's
it was
not
early.
True.
It was so early. These guys were...
You were there later, I remember.
Yeah, these guys were there so early. I was like, what time do you guys get up?
Yeah, that was a crazy trip because then it was Guro at 6 in the morning. We were doing some stuff. And then 7:30, 8 o'clock, then Mark was there, I remember. And then we trained from about 8 to about 9:30. Then we would get breakfast. Then we did the instructor camp. I remember the instructor camp went from 11 to 4. We had an hour break and went from 5 to 10.
That's right.
I was dead. Oh, wow. I was dead. I'm really like, I remember being so tired after those trips and being at the end of the trip going in a jacuzzi the morning I was leaving, and I was just so tired. So when someone said to me, oh, you're not training very hard, I went, actually, compared to most people, like 4 hours bad, 4 to 6.
No lie. Bad.
But compared to, you know, before, you know, maybe it's not.
Well, not only that, but you're in your 40s now, and in your 40s, when you're in your 40s, you know, you slow down a little bit.
Yeah.
You just don't do doubles. You do singles.
I actually saw a snail going past me the other day there as I was walking along the road. So that's how slow I've got. That's been a great week. It's been a real privilege. And I love coming here and seeing Coach Erik. And it's just really, really great. I'm just really, really blown away. And I'm just privileged. Yeah, I'm really great.
If it wasn't for Tanya and Rick helping me out, they wouldn't be seeing me this year.
In another week, it's been exactly a year.
Yes, yeah, and it's exactly. And it's odd that Rick made it out exactly at the same time. And another thing that's odd is he's starting to get just a little bit sick at the same time. Is that weird?
It's strange, isn't it? Because I had
Please don't go that route, though.
It could be changing of the seasons. It could be having wind blowing on you. Do you have your air conditioner on in the hotel?
No.
No. Oh. Wow.
And it's been a great week, so I'm really happy. And you know, when I come here anyway, I get kind of a lot of energy from it. And I'm going to go back, you know, feel re-energized, rested, ready to go, you know. So
are you really still teaching a lot at home?
I'm sorry?
Are you still teaching a lot at home?
Yeah, teaching a lot, over 20 classes a week, you know.
Wow.
And, you know, teach a lot.
20 classes a week? That's over 20, wow.
Yeah. But the good thing for me is because I'm not doing, I mean, since Eric will say that when you're doing, if you're doing seminars like he is, that just the travel, the amount of travel is there is going to suck your energy, right? I mean, it's great to travel and teach. It's going to suck your energy. For me now, I'm not doing very many, as many seminars, hardly any seminars. I'm not doing private lessons. I'm not teaching private lessons. So basically, I'm going in teaching classes. And for me, because when I go to my gym, I know everybody. Everybody's really cool. It's really nice. You know, just a great atmosphere, you know, to be in, you know. So I get a lot of energy back from that. So it's great.
How's your enrollment? You have a lot of students now.
We got over 300 now. Yeah, over 300
students.
Whoa, that really grew.
Well, that not only that, but that also helps it. When you have that many students, it helps you to stay home more because you don't have to travel, correct?
Yes, exactly.
I mean, if you don't have that many students, sometimes you have to do a lot of seminars or workshops to make up for it.
Yeah.
But when you have, you know, an entirely great, well-oiled machine, it's your school, and he's got tons of black belts that are teaching for him also. That's wonderful. There's nothing better than that. And you're comfortable and you're happy, you know, and people are showing up and learning from the best, getting information, and they also pay, which is cool.
I think, you know, as Coach was saying, that I think just the fact you're in your own school, you know everybody, you know, and you're looking at someone's progress like week to week, you know, rather than like 6 months to 6 months, like if you're doing seminars. And again, and for me, is when the school wasn't going so well, I was doing a lot more seminars. And it was great because it was happening organically where I was getting asked to do more seminars. So that was fantastic. And then now the school's come up, the seminars are going down quite a bit. So everything's, you know, kind of balanced out, you know. And I feel really fortunate that we really blessed. Blessed.
If you notice something, notice what's in Rick's left hand as he lifts his hand up. His right hand. Both hands.
That's a pretty good little switch there.
What is that? What are those?
This is Eric just...
What do you call him?
Coach just handed me a knuckle duster.
They call them knuckle dusters over
there. Actually, as we were speaking, I got my finger stuck, but I didn't want to... I was trying to pull it out, you know. So we're going to have one of those things where I'm going to have to kind of come over and get something on it.
So
to get my finger in it.
So they just put soap water, or a little bit of oil.
Okay, it's free. It's free now. Thank you.
This is so funny. Everybody's so nice now because I was talking with Greg yesterday. Greg Nelson was on, and he's so nice now. And it's like people, like maybe newer people coming along, are meeting these nice people. It's like back in the day, these guys were killers. They still are. It's just they're just nice now. Everybody's so mellow. Rick didn't even want to show the brass knuckles.
Even look at Tyson now. When there's a lot of videos coming up with Tyson, and he's such a nice guy. Yeah. He's really coming across.
It's because he's healed from doing his courses. He's going out and talking, and he's telling his story, and he's writing books, and he's telling his story.
Yeah,
and that's healing him.
He's a really interesting person.
Well, that's healing him. And by him talking about it like that, he's now, uh-oh. What's up, Alan?
Hey, Coach.
Alan Baker.
Are you there?
Uh-oh. Turn your video on, buddy.
There you are.
I hope you're parked. Are you parked?
Good boy. Are you a good boy?
Can you hear us?
I can hear your finger. Can you hear us, Alan?
Now I got you.
There now he is. What's going on, buddy?
I just got finished doing a little training, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and I am on 95, enjoying the traffic on my way up to Jacksonville, Florida.
You're going to Jacksonville to see Guro Dan?
Yes, sir.
And he's at Lee Peacock's.
That's right.
That's cool.
Awesome.
I think nice. Iris, Dennis, Steven, the whole staff's going to be there this weekend. So.
All right.
Oh, sweet. You know, Guro's seminars have been flat out packed lately.
Great. It's wonderful.
That's great.
It just, I mean, up at Jeff Jones's, I mean, you couldn't even move in that room. There were so many people there. And there were over 30 instructors in that one room.
That's awesome.
So do you think that movie helps also for normal people to want to see Guro Dan?
What's that?
Once Upon a Time in Hollywood?
I don't think so. You know, that guy retracted that headline, you know, where Bruce Lee protege slams Tarantino or whatever. He didn't do that. Guro Dan doesn't do that. And anybody who knows him knows he doesn't get pulled into crap like that.
Yeah. Right.
So they actually retracted that story, and I'm glad they did, because
Shannon made it a point. Shannon, yeah. She wanted that. And then they wouldn't release it in China.
Yeah.
And then Quentin said that he was actually going to make a new ending and recreate or redo the Daydream.
He did. Really? I didn't hear that.
I didn't either.
I just had read that they were talking about him reshooting or creating an alternate ending or an alternate part just because of the controversy.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like Tarantino. He doesn't usually let people mess with his work.
Well, but I think so many people got offended by the, you know, here's the deal. You got offended because you weren't watching the movie. Because if you watched the movie, you would know he was daydreaming.
Yeah, I might have missed a point. It's either a flashback or a daydream. It's one or the other, but it's also in that stunt guy. It's in Cliff's head, how he saw it. Of course, Bruce Lee wasn't like that. I didn't know him, but you know, of course it wasn't like that, but it was a funny scene. It was a funny scene.
You know him. You had that tracksuit on. You did that whole scene.
I did. I did have the tracksuit. I had the frog button suit too.
Here, let's cut to that scene.
I love Bruce Lee. I wanted to be Bruce Lee. Who didn't, right? When I was a kid, I loved Bruce Lee. I'm a Bruce Lee fanatic.
Do you have that? Can we watch that clip?
I'll have to maybe cut in Enter the Basement. Have you seen that, Rick?
I've never had the pleasure of seeing that clip.
So it was around 1982, 83, and I had a Super 8 camera. My dad had one, and that little 5-minute cartridges of film you put in it. And I had the track suit. I got it for Christmas, the yellow track suit with the black stripe, and did my own fight choreography. I did a Jeet Tech in it and did some trapping and stuff, and I didn't even know what a Jeet Tech was. I was just copying Bruce Lee.
That's awesome.
And we did all kinds of stupid moves and everything. We were doing stunts. We didn't know we were doing them. But that, and so I threw that up a few years ago on Facebook, but I recut it with Game of Death music and stuff, put all the sound effects and stuff in.
I'd love to see it. I tell you about the tracksuit. When I went to the first It was the first Bruce Lee convention, I think 1979. It might have been 1980. They had two Bruce Lee conventions in London. Guro Dan came in them both.
Awesome.
But they had the tracksuit from Game of Death.
Oh, the real one.
The real one. Yeah, and it had the foot. If I remember, it had the footprint, like where. And so I don't know if they messed around with that or whatever. But I remember you weren't supposed to touch it, but I put my hand on the foot, you know, and it was such a big moment for me, you know, to actually touch the.
That's so great.
It was really kind of silly, but you know, it was really.
No
really,
way, not to me. Yeah. Let's geek out.
Yeah, Grace Lee was there, and Robert Lee was there. Yeah.
Wow.
His mother, met his brother. Yeah.
That's cool.
So that was really cool. That was really, and obviously met Guro, which is, you know.
Did you know Guro back then? In 79?
There was two. The first one was in 79, and then it was 1980. And I forget which one I met them at. I think it might have been the second one, 1980. That's when I actually, in the first one in 79, I shook hands with Guro. The second one, 1980, just after that, 2 days later, I trained with them. And that was the first time I actually trained with them in Birmingham, in England. But anyway, the tracksuit, yeah, just you mentioned the tracksuit. I remember touching it and thinking, I have the power, you know?
I would have passed out. That would have been such a cool moment.
It was cool, yeah, for me, for a kid. Like that, I was like, wow, that's great, you know?
Really cool. How old were you?
17, 18, something like that.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, it was really cool, yeah.
I'm so geeking out right now. That's so
and great. I remember getting, like, they had a lot of those. You probably have them, Bob, if you're a Bruce Lee geek. The Japanese, they had these Japanese books. They're very expensive at the time, and they had a lot of foes.
You guys talk for a second.
Uh-oh.
I have that here somewhere. You guys keep going for a second. I'll be right back.
Are you?
I got to find it.
So, Alan, you're driving across. How far do you have to drive?
I've got about 5 hours.
Wow. And so LaVon got her brown belt, I heard.
Yes. How about that? It was kind of a surprise test.
That's good.
I believe Teddy might have known about it, and he's doing a review for his black belt test. Next month, he's going to be in Virginia testing for his black belt. So he said, if you're going to be in town, let's do a review. And I said, well, why don't you ask Sifu LaVon to come and do the review? And she got out there and did it and did a great job. I got to say, did a fantastic job.
Wow.
And so we
– people don't know, LaVon, it was she was a high-level black belt in Japanese jiu-jitsu.
I did not know that.
Oh, yeah, you should have seen her do – Guro had Mark McFan and her do trapping into throws, and he called out all the throws, and she launched Mark over her head. Then Mark threw her, and she hit the floor, and I was like, holy crap. Not only could she throw, she could fall. And Guro at lunch, remember, he said, a lot of people don't know this, but boy, LaVon can really take a fall.
She's badass. LaVon's badass.
I remember her doing it with Leo Gahe at Guro's, and it was in the 90s sometime. And he was, going after her, and she handled it like a pro.
Yeah, she's tough.
Yeah.
Oh. What is that book? Is that volume one, book B?
Oh, yeah, I had the, yeah, yes.
What's up? And the other side's the nunchuck scene.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You know, that's crazy. I haven't seen that for years. I had them.
I used to take this to school with me every day and get some Bruce Lee in school.
You know, the other books were really high quality, typical Japanese from right to left. And I had photos that I had never seen at the time. And then I gave something, I think it was three, and I gave someone a loan of them and never got them back.
So I'll give them back. I think I have them here somewhere.
I got one more show and tell thing for you. Bob Carver just sent me two magazines from like 1967, Black Belt with Bruce Lee on the cover, and they're originals.
Wow, I'd love to see. So Coach, did you award LaVon her brown belt? Did you award her the brown belt?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. Really nice.
Yeah, she didn't know it was coming, you know. She thought it was a review for Teddy. I got there a day or two early, went and visited all the jiu-jitsu schools in town trying to find a brown belt. Nobody had one.
It's funny because when I was there 2 weeks ago and I said, LaVon, you're still a purple belt? And she goes, well, that's all she said. Well.
She just said, well. That sounds like LaVon.
You just said, well. I've got the other
one. She goes, you know, I'm older and I go slow and I take my time. You know, I'm not in any hurry. And I just said, all it takes is like, I don't know, what, $300 and $300.
Wow.
Wow. You know, it's a crazy thing is like,
hold on, you're sounding like, doesn't he sound like, what's his name? Kanye, you sound like Kanye right now.
Oh, you're auto-tuned.
Did it sound better?
No, it's cool. It sounded like you were singing. Mm. Bob, put that up again. What is that?
Check this out.
Wow.
This is from 1967.
Wow.
That was a year after I was born.
No, it wasn't. You're a year older than me.
Huh?
You're a year older than me.
I was born in 1966.
Yeah. Oh, Bob, you said a year after. I thought you said a year before.
Oh, man. No.
Erik always calls me his dad when we go to the – we got in for seniors last time we went to the movie. So he's over there telling – then Rick, he's like, Rick, you look so young. When I go see him, he goes, Bob's my dad.
No, I did it as a joke one time, and this guy goes, well, so we went to the theater. We got 3 senior citizen discounts, and they go, okay.
He didn't even ask us. He just gave us the senior.
Yep.
And he goes, one for my dad. And the guy didn't even blink. I was like, really, man?
Someone said, what are you guys up to? And I go, oh, not much. Just taking my dad out for a birthday dinner.
The guy believed it.
Oh, that's so cool. That's so nice of you. Guys,
didn't have his gray goatee then.
You guys, you'd catch up with your dad.
I was like, man, that sucks. I get to be the old dude. Oh, man.
So next time you can tell him, just say that I'm your grandpa. What happens?
I'm like out here with my coach who's younger than me. But,
taking gramps to the movie.
Yeah. I hope you guys have recliners.
And blankets. We need some blankets.
And blankets. Yeah. You guys have
the hearing aids in there?
Get some of the old funnels.
That's a joke.
Oh, man. Awesome. I love it. So what are you guys up to tonight? What's on the agenda tonight?
Rick has got a 6 o'clock meeting, so we were going to go out and get some lunch. It'd probably take him to the Fish Grill or somewhere like that because he's a vegetarian, right? Oh,
did you go? Have you seen the Game Changers?
No, I've not seen it. No.
I haven't seen it yet.
Everybody's talking about it, and some people are saying it's really great, and it's. You know, that's where I'm going to go. And then another guy in my gym, a couple of guys in my gym were going, nah, there's a lot of stuff, you know, that I don't really agree with, you know. But so I'm not really sure. I don't really know.
I think it's inspiring. I'm not saying that because they shot it at my school. All the footage I rolled with James Wilkes.
Yeah.
And I let him catch me a bunch of times just because it would look really good and they didn't use any of it. And then Ben was in it. They didn't use any of that, but they used a lot of background stuff. I think James is being respectful. You know, he just put him doing a little bit of stuff and him doing a lot of battle rope stuff. But, you know, I watched it and it really did make me want to, you know, cut some meat out of my diet.
Yeah.
And start eating more vegan or less, you know, and started eating more vegetable. I started eating more ever since I got sick. I started eating more veggies anyways, you know, and you could tell, like, if you don't have salad and vegetables in your diet, you could just tell.
Oh, yeah. You can't go wrong with eating just all the veggies you want.
No. And you can eat as many vegetables as you want. Right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You probably had so many potatoes, but
no, not the starchy stuff, but like, you know, yeah. Broccoli.
Ellen, you have a beautiful rainbow coming in on your head, right, Bob? You see it?
You do.
You got some lens flares going. I'll call J.J. Abrams. You can be in Star Trek.
All right.
Can I run out for a few minutes? Yes, I'm going to quickly run out. Okay.
Elvis has left the building.
This is our random thoughts podcast. There's no particular subject. It's just there's just a whole bunch of awesomeness going on.
Yeah, it was nice to know that Rick was in town. I'm doing a leg lock 2 seminar on Sunday, which is leg locks 2.0. I did a pop-up seminar about a month ago. Surprisingly, I said, hey, on a Monday, I got back from a seminar, and I go, what am I doing this weekend? Tony goes, you got the weekend off. And I go, all right, I'll do a seminar on Sunday at the school on leg locks. And she's like, you can't do that. It's too fast, too soon. Sure enough, I did it, and there was almost 50 people there.
That's huge.
Yeah. Wow. So, same thing. Same recipe. On a Monday, I said, I'm going to do another seminar on Sunday, but I'm going to do 2.0, more advanced leg attacks. And then I went to all the students and I said, hey, you know what sucks is you guys were all CSW students and you're supposed to be known for leg locks. And I'm teaching the advanced leg lock workshop on Sunday. And you know what sucks would be all the neighbor schools coming in and learning all those leg locks and you guys don't even know. And next thing you guys are in tournaments and these guys are catching you guys with leg locks.
Take that CSW shirt off.
You know, I don't do workshops at the school very often. You know, I have our camp, but I haven't been doing too many workshops. And personally, I haven't been teaching any workshops there. So, you know, it's a kind of a good chance for guys to come in and get 3 hours grilled with 3 hours of leg attacks.
Well, if anybody, I just put up the little back attacks thing from the blue to purple curriculum the other day. That thing went crazy because you impromptu just started doing banana splits and a whole bunch of achilles locks and all the stuff.
It was weird how we just went off on that one.
That wasn't we. That came out of your head.
Well, I don't think that we actually had that planned out. The short choke came from Scotland. It came from Edinburgh. Rick brought me to a place out in the middle of a pasture. And I go, where are we training? He goes, we're training here, out in the middle of the pasture. And we walked.
He's not exaggerating either. It's like, it's called Newton Grange near Edinburgh in his old mining village. And they had like a little hut.
It looks like a lawnmower shack.
Yeah, basically, yeah. And it was...
I go, where are we training? He goes, here. And I go, it's a lawnmower shack. And then we get in there and Rick tries to make me put a black belt on. I was like, no way. You got world-class judokas in there. There's not a possibility. You know, it's already bad enough he's bringing a guest in. And they're like, oh, fresh meat. Who's the fresh meat, Rick? I hope you brought some Lowry seasoning salt. Next thing you know, it was just odd because the girl, what was her name, the blondie?
Mandy
lays face down. She goes like this. She goes face down, and they go, you're first. And I go, what am I supposed to do? And they go, turn her over. I mean, I was trying to pull her arm out, and she was defending so good and defending her neck. I was like, screw it. So I just reached down and grabbed her ankle and started to ankle lock her. And all of a sudden he goes, what are you doing? And I go, I'll go for an ankle lock. He goes, we don't do that shit here. He goes, what's wrong with you? Haven't you ever grappled before? And I go, no, today is my first day. And he goes, you can tell.
You can tell.
I was mortified. I bring my coach, I bring a friend, and we go there. But it was a different rule set. And the interesting thing is that they really respect Eric. I mean,
no,
really,
they don't.
No, they do for sure. But they really, because they never realized there was like a little bit of confusion. And I think
the rules are different, right?
The rules are different, yeah. And it was interesting because I think there was only about five or six of us. It was myself, Coach Erik, Billy Cusack, who's a fantastic new Wazza player, Graham Randall, Mandy Costello, and they were all like British to world class players. Graham was world champion in 99. But they really think a lot of you. They really, and it was just kind of like a misunderstanding of the rules, but it was quite fun. I was kind of mortified and laughing at the same time.
They go, "Why would you do that?" And I go, "Well, because I can't turn her over, so I go for her legs." And they go, "No, but that's illegal. You can't do that." And I was like, "Oh." I go, "Well, you know, without a gi on." And they go, why would we take off our kits? Because a kit is a gi. They call it a kit, but they go, "Why would we take our kits off?" And I go, "Well, you know, in pro fighting, you don't get to wear a kit." And they're like, "Huh?" But it was weird because that kind of started the relationship. And I started trying to bring in power cables, these rubber lifeline cables for the judokas. I asked them about the cable stuff and about wrestling a little bit, because I saw that some of the guys would do a clap and they put their head down, straight arm out, and grab your legs. Remember that?
Yeah.
And I go, "Wow, you guys must have strong lower backs to be able to hit a double leg like that." And he goes, "What are you talking about?" I go, "Well, you guys are bent over. Your legs aren't even underneath. You just bent over and your arms are out." And he goes, "So how would you do it different?" And I go, "Well, I penetrate with the shot." And in front of all these guys, you remember, he goes, "Show me." And I was like, I wasn't saying. And he goes, "Show me." And I was like, So then I had to do a penetration step. And then
just shoot a double on him?
Yeah, but hit a penetration step and then step up and then throw. And you're not allowed to touch your knee down, right? Were you allowed to touch?
I think they changed. You know, they've changed it now. You can't do any leg grabs now in judo. You know that?
No leg grabs. Yeah.
No leg grabs.
Well, so you were allowed. Yeah. What was it called? Marotigari. Marotigari is the name of the double leg, and it was a big. There was actually one of the judo newaza books out on the double legs that all the Georgians were using.
Fundable.
Because the Georgians were half wrestlers, half judokas, and they're notorious for their overgrips and their double legs. And because it's half, it's almost like sambo. A lot of those wrestlers.
You can do that in sambo, right?
Yes, but not in judo anymore. Okay. So no double legs, no two-handed grip breaks. What else?
Yeah.
You have to use one hand to strip a grip.
Yeah, I think there's no singles. I think I've not got it exactly, but I think once you grip, you can't start to break. You've got to grip and throw. You've got to go right. No crossover, no far side lapel grips. That's been around for a while. Too strong a grip, no belt grips. A lot of different, but it's interesting because I think it has made judo more exciting, but it just took away a big part of the sport, you know. Like when it took leg locks out of judo, right?
Yeah.
You know, because leg locks obviously were in judo. And,
what was happening is with the cannibas throw, which is the back crab scissor throw, guys were getting their thigh bones sheared in half. They were hitting jumping scissor throws, and guys were getting their legs broke. So they took the cannibas out. And now Eddie Bravo put it back in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Mm-hmm. Alan.
Yep.
You know exactly where he's going with that, right? Hey, do you remember that old movie from like 1980 called Budo?
Yes, yeah, it was great.
There was a great judo section in that. Do you remember that, Rick?
It was sumo. It was where they were forcing the sumo wrestlers to do the splits, and the guy ripped his crotch.
I see Okano in it. Did he strangle his student unconscious?
I think so.
Yes.
Yes, I've seen that. Yeah, that's really good.
The guy chopped off the bottle tops.
Okano is a beast. He's the guy who, the guy in that, that I see Okano was, in 1961, he was armlocked by a Russian in Japan. And he tapped. And I think his arm was broken, but even though he tapped, but the Japanese, he was shunned by the Japanese community because he was embarrassed as well, because they said, you should never have tapped. So for 9 months, he stayed in his house, never went out, trained in his house, set up the tatami, trained there, came back. He won the Olympics in 64, I think. Won the Olympics in 64, won the All Japan. He's only 80 kilos, won the All Japan twice, open weight. Amazing player, amazing. A real beast, a real great Iwaza. Good groundwork too, very good groundwork. Yeah, so yeah, he's an amazing player. But I think that'll be the same one. And I remember that documentary where he strangled the student unconscious, just a short technique. You know,
That's such a great one. It's still good. It holds up. I just bought it like a couple years ago on iTunes.
Yeah, I've seen it for a long time. Yeah.
It's so good. The sumo one is one of my favorite parts in it. That guy, that student, he can't lay his chest flat when he's doing the.
They all sit on him, and you can hear his
screams.
It sounded like they pulled the legs off of a.
They sit on his back and they push him down. They start hitting him with a stick. Yeah, he's like, oh, he screams. It's like, wow, I don't want to do that. That's not nice. But they had the women with the naginata, and then they had the a lot of emphasis on the sword, on the
karate too.
On the katana. The karate guy was like beating up a train, and he was like hitting metal stuff with, and he was putting his fingers through an apple like it was nothing. Really tough.
You
tough
guys. Like it was yesterday.
Yeah, that's a good one. I recommend that one. That's a really cool one.
That was a great. It was called Budo, you remember?
Yep, Budo.
I got the name of it, but yeah.
It's still available. You can still see it. It probably have a bunch of clips on YouTube from it. And they're always running around barefoot, like in the snow, wearing their gis.
And also underneath the, what do you call, waterfall.
Yeah.
They're all frozen, no shirts on.
Remember Rickson did that in Choke?
Yeah, that was cool.
He was in the pools in Japan, and he was doing all that breathing stuff. Edward Norton was just on Joe Rogan, I think this week, the actor Edward Norton, and he was talking about, did you know he knew Rickson?
Because he had met him on The Incredible Hulk.
On The Hulk, and he talked about that, and he figured the backstory for David Banner should be he was trying to control this rage in him, and he was in Brazil hiding out, and he went to who's the best guy to teach him that control and the breathing. And because he remembered he saw a Choke, and he went and got Rickson, and Rickson was in it. And there's a scene in that movie, apparently, that he was working with Rickson on the, all that abdominal stuff and the breathing and all. It's pretty cool.
He learned that from his wife, cause his wife was a yogi.
That's so neat.
Yeah, his wife Kim was a yogi, and she taught him all the breathing stuff.
I never knew that, really. Yeah. Wow.
Edward Norton knows a lot about the Gracies too. If you check that podcast out, he just published it. I just caught a little bit of it earlier. It's really interesting. He's telling all the backstory about Maeda and Helio and all this stuff. It's Edward Norton was given a pretty good jiu-jitsu.
That's historical.
Lesson. Yeah, it's pretty neat. Yeah, it was a good interview. I didn't know he knew all that. And he gets into stuff about Brando and all that. It's like, wow, this guy knows a lot of stuff. He's pretty smart.
Well, you know, in the American Submission Wrestling book that we did, and when it came out and there was a picture of Maeda in wrestling shorts doing a half Nelson, which is a wrestling pose in wrestling shorts. I remember a lot of the jiu-jitsu guys were trying to downplay that and act as though, you know, that wasn't part of the roots of BJJ. And they didn't understand that back then in the late 1800s, early 1900s, the carnival wrestlers, a lot of the guys, if they loved, they were passionate about the sport, that's how they made a living. They took all comers on. Anytime they got a challenge, they would do it, and it was all for money. You know, Maeda had over 1,000 matches, over 1,000 paid matches, carnival style matches.
That's crazy.
And then if there was a feud between two people and they had a major issue, they would do a rough and tumble. But the only problem with the rough and tumble was they would allow gouging, biting. And so people were getting their lips bit off, their nose bit off, the ear bit off. What are the odds of dying in the early 1900s if you get your nose bit off?
Yeah, a lot of infection, right?
Yeah. And a lot of the old catch wrestlers are no longer around today because of the fact that they constricted conjunctivitis. They would get a toothache, they would get impetigo, and there was no cure for it. And also the poverty. They were impoverished so bad, and if there was no money, a lot of them committed suicide.
Wow, really?
I sat down with Billy Robinson.
Wow.
And we went and had a beer after training one day, and I gave him a couple beers, and he opened up like a book and just started revealing a ton of stuff. And one thing that he said was that a lot of the catch wrestlers, they were no longer around because of suicide. A lot of them died young because of constricting diseases, but a lot of them also, conjunctivitis, you'd go blind. If you got pink eye, well, what was a cure for pink eye back then?
Did they even have antibiotics and stuff like that back then? I don't think so, right?
Penicillin, right? But you got impetigo. You got conjunctivitis, and then you got, a toothache. If you get a toothache, you had to pull it out. But, a lot of people would go crazy because they would get a bad tooth. And it affects your brain. They'd get, a staph infection in the brain.
So Carnival wrestling, now you say rough and tumble. So is there a difference? Like, what's a rough and tumble versus a standard carnival wrestling match?
Rough and tumble is that we're going to go, we have a major problem with each other. And it's not a gentleman's sport where I'm going to shake hands and we could either win by a pin or by a submission. The rough and tumble is you're going to go until one person has to give up. And these guys are biting. They're ripping each other's ears. They're biting. They're tearing the face.
Damn.
Anything goes.
Yeah. That's a rough and tumble.
Okay.
That's not IBJJF.
What'd he say?
It's not IBJJF legal. So they don't train it. See, heel hook. It's not IBJJF legal, so they don't train it, which I disagree. Take your gi off, and it's legal in every single tournament out there.
It should be legal at black belt, right?
Maybe, but I think the problem is it's so there's so much stigma around that heel hook. The amount of injury that you get from a heel hook is it takes you off the mat for 6 months to a year.
Damn.
Alan, you're going to need to mute your – can you mute your microphone for a little bit? You're in some really loud traffic right now. Can you mute that? All right, cool. Yeah. That's better. You can still listen in, buddy.
can you hear us? How many fingers am I holding up?
So back to the heel hook stuff. What? Eddie Bravo talked about this once on, it was probably on Joe as well. Might've been on his, you got booed, in a really early match, right? This is probably pre UFC, isn't it? But 96. you did a leg lock in a, jiu-jitsu tournament.
96, but,
UFC.
Was already Achilles done. Lock.
Okay.
And, I was down. So they go, you guys got 1 minute, and the clock was ticking and neither one of us had points, so I just wrapped an ankle and I just dove, and then the guy countered and I rolled right, and then he countered and I rolled left, and then he countered and I rolled right, and then he tapped. I rolled left and right. And I was all excited and I went, yeah, and everyone's like, boo. And then what does Jean LaBelle say? Blow kisses. That's so people are going to boo you. So you blow kisses and you bow.
And you went and had a little convo with Eddie in the parking lot after that, right? Because he talked about that, right?
Yeah, we were talking and people were talking about leg lock stuff. But Dave Novigrad, after my first match, I suplexed a guy and then I mounted him and dismounted Katagatami. And he goes, hey, next time in your next match, when you get mount, you might want to stay there longer. And I go, why? He goes, because of points. And I go, but I submitted my opponent.
Yeah.
And he goes, yeah, but you got to understand this is jiu-jitsu, and you get points if you stay there longer.
Does it matter when you submitted him?
Yeah, I go, but I ultimately, I did the ultimate, which is the submission. And he's like, yeah, just be aware of the whole holding your position longer thing. And I was just like, wow, I want to submit everybody. I don't want to hold people. Can you imagine holding people to death? That's boring, man.
Thank you very much.
Rick submits all his guys, especially when you're in the crowd yelling Juji and he's looking around for his dog. He's like,
my dog was called Juji after the Juji Gatami armbar.
That's awesome.
And I was at a Pan Am's, and anyway, I'm fighting, and I get a mount on this guy, and all I hear is Juji.
He's right there. He's so good at the armbar. So
the guy did. I mean, he was a black belt. It was a white belt. But he made a mistake. He was tired. He tried to push me off, so I armbarred him. And Eric was like, "Yeah, Juji.
But here's the deal. Nobody knows. It's weird, but most black belts today don't know the name of the armbar. They don't know the Japanese name. So, you know how like Eddie Bravo uses code? All of his system is code, right?
Yeah.
That's all I have to do with Rick is just yell out something in Japanese, and most people don't know it, right? He's a Gatami.
That's the thing about
knee bar.
The thing about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, I wish we spoke Portuguese. You know, I had Portuguese terms for an armbar. I know we do Mataleo and all that and Omoplata, but just as a general thing, because for Judo, if I come to Los Angeles and say Uchimata, it's a Judo at school, they know what Uchimata is. So we know if I go to Sweden, if I go to Japan, if I go to Germany. So it's a universal thing. But the problem sometimes people will say to me, they'll go, Rick, have you seen the London or something? And I will go, what's the London? And show me the position of, all right, okay, or the Chicago Blues or whatever else Eddie Bravo's calling it, you know. And you kind of go, but there's no general terms in jiu-jitsu, you know, for that. Well, what is Coach Allen, is he?
Yeah, judo.
Yeah, but you can't talk because in traffic, right? But you know, I think it's one of those things that I wish we had a universal thing in jiu-jitsu that we would say, like, mount position would be called XYZ.
In Tate. Portuguese.
Tate. Tate Shio Gatami, right? Yeah.
Tate.
Tate Shio, Yoko Shio, Kami Shio, you know.
Sensei Yuri. I asked Sensei Yuri one time. I said, Sensei Yuri, what's the name for mount in Japanese? He goes, Mounto. And I go, what's the name for the guard? He goes, Gardo. And I go, really? And then it was like, I asked every position, crossbody, Yoko, Keiza Gatami, Kazuri Keiza, Kami Shiho Gatami, north and south.
But that, I mean, the Japanese terms are great because you have that. But
they label
it. I don't know, maybe Coach Allen, do you use
Japanese terminology?
Japanese terminology or Portuguese terminology when you teach?
In class, not that often, but we go over it a lot with the instructors, so they know.
Right. Okay, that's interesting. Okay.
That's good.
Do you go over like side control, use a Portuguese term, mount, things like that?
Well, most of the stuff of the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu was taught to me.
In English?
Yeah, in English.
Right.
Pedro Sauer's so, got a great command of the English language.
Yeah, yeah. Me too, yeah. Yeah.
Well, no, some guys, their Portuguese is so strong that they don't know the name, the English name for any position or for, so they call it the Portuguese name. Alan, Tanya. Tanya, say hi.
Hi.
Hey, hi, what's Alan. Up? What's going on?
He's in the middle of traffic.
Long time no see, stranger. Ooh, Jiggy. Jiggy's just mad about everything.
He's just angry. Everybody's in my house.
He just flopped over. He's so funny. I have to go. I just came in to say bye because I have to run to the school and I have to go mail out some stuff.
Well, you are.
Yeah.
Have you been lurking a little bit on the side next to Rick where we couldn't see you, but you were listening in anyway?
She was outside the window.
I've been working. Yeah, I've been with a little glass with my ear in the glass. Just whatever everybody was saying.
I'm honored you graced us with your presence. The queen was here for a little while.
I'm here. Awesome. I'm always here. I'm ever present. I just don't have to be seen all the time.
You're much more popular than you realize.
That's the truth. Yeah.
Girl power. That's awesome. So please come back on with us when you're not so busy. I'm gonna hound you. We're gonna get you back on maybe next week while the coach camp's going on.
Oh, sweet Lord.
Well, you have Wonder Woman, you have Supergirl, and then you, right? What's the other one? Isn't there another one?
There's Tanya Paulson.
No, there's three. There's three TV shows. I mean, there was Wonder Woman, but you have Supergirl out, and then there's another one now.
There's a new one? Well, Captain Marvel's a woman now.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Oh, okay. Uh-oh, controversy. Comic-Con people are going to come get you.
Yeah, good luck with that, Comic-Con people.
We're talking to Captain America. We won't go much longer, Tanya, I promise. We won't keep them on forever, but we'll end it in another little bit.
On a little bit of a timeline, I know we went down the wormhole.
Do you guys have any questions, like any – you guys want to know any punchlines or anything?
We don't have to ask for those. Those are coming out all the time. I have a question. What year did Coach Erik and Coach Rick start training in Shooto?
Well, Coach Erik is
1988.
I'm
leaving you guys.
88. Bye, Tanya.
Bye, guys. Just text. Yeah. You guys are done.
Okay. Probably not me. I met you in 89, so... I think 89.
Are you sure? You met me earlier than that. Maybe. Well, I have a picture of Rick and I sparring from
1987. Yeah,
that's great.
Or maybe 86 or, no, 87 was the Smoky Mountain camp. 87 or 88.
Yeah.
That camp came up yesterday. Greg was talking about that with LaVon.
They were all there at that. So there was a couple that I wasn't. That was the first one I went to. Greg, I think, was doing it every year.
Yeah.
All I remember was forgetting my sleeping bag on the airplane, sleeping in my tent, and there was this much water in the bottom of my tent, and all I could hear was whispers, and I thought everyone was out talking, and then I looked out my tent, and everyone was sleeping. And then I go, who the hell's talking? And then I go, hey, what's the deal with this land? And then all of a sudden I find out that the land is Indian burial ground.
Oh no, you got visited?
Yeah, everyone was saying that they could hear whispers all night long. So I ended up sleeping in the, up in the, what's that thing? What was that, the
house?
Yeah, up in the house.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, because we got rained out. So Rick and I didn't sleep together, but we slept. And if I recall, I think Rick had a girlfriend from Chicago back then.
There was
right.
Yeah. Probably don't want to go public with that, but
it's not public. It was like, he was young and single. It's okay. Anyways,
so 88. You met? Did you start training with Yuri Nakamura first or Satoru Sayama?
Well, I've actually never trained with I've dummied for Yuri Nakamura, but I've never trained with him.
Okay.
With him, all my Shooto has come from Coach Erik. You know, all that I know about Shooto. You know.
Do you know Rick and I did a demo
coming from?
Did you remember the demo that we did in Scotland?
Huddersfield, Huddersfield, yeah.
We went to a super seminar and they made us do a demo. So Rick and I we just went back and forth, punch, kick, throw, takedown. And then Buster came in on that one, right? Buster Reeves.
What inspired
that. No kidding. That's cool.
Buster Reeves is Christopher Reeves' nephew. No, but Buster Reeves, he's in movies full time now, right? He's in movies full time.
Yeah, he's done very well.
He's in The Accountant also. You know, with
The Accountant was really good. That was all C-Lot.
He's one of the special forces guys in the house.
Yeah, have you seen The Accountant, Coach Rick?
That is a good movie.
That's Ben Affleck. It's really good.
Yeah.
Watch
out.
Yeah.
He does C-Lot. There's this like training montage when they were kids, and it was like, wow, man, they actually put C-Lot all up in a movie like that. And they did it with what's that?
That's Greg and Terry Gibson.
Is it Terry Gibson?
And Mark McFadden.
That's a great picture.
That's a funny picture.
Well, Greg looks like a kid there.
You're feeling nice.
That's great.
Greg looks younger now than he does in that picture.
Yeah, Greg's a stud.
Have you had Mark on the podcast? Has he been on?
We have not.
That'd be cool.
That would be awesome.
Oh,
Mark McFadden.
Oh, no.
That's a good idea.
Mark's got so many stories. You got to just get him by himself.
No. We got to have you because you're the encyclopedia too.
No, he's got a million pictures. He literally has a million ideas. He's got a million stories. You know, I mean, Mark's been around and back. And his stories are super funny.
Yeah.
I love it.
Ask him why he got sent to England.
So make a little note of that one.
Yeah, when he was active, he got sent to England because he got in trouble.
So you're setting me up. I'll probably ask him that question, and he'll immediately sign off and hate me forever.
We're going to need Coach.
His commanding officer was giving him crap the whole time. And he said, you're going to have to stop that. One of these days, he goes, you know, you're going to pay for it. And sure enough, he sure did. You got to let him tell the story, though, because it's so funny.
I'm ignorant on all of that.
Yeah, but we need you on there to ask those questions.
Yeah.
You'll be the catalyst that gets those stories rolling.
I mean, so, it was a blessing for him because the Brits embraced him big time, didn't they?
Yeah.
When he was over, they loved him.
Yeah.
He had a great group of guys. He called them Mama's Boys. Mark McFadden's boys were called Mama's Boys. I don't, why'd they call them Mama's? Mark.
MM.
Yeah.
MM Boys.
Yeah, Mark McFadden's martial arts. So, but Mama's Boys. But interesting, he had a great group of guys, and he did really well, you know, and he was over there and embraced the culture, and it actually fared well for him to go over there. He could have stayed there. He said the biggest problem he had was he was going over there to do some workshops, and he told me, he goes, I stayed too long. I was here too long. He stayed over there for a month. He did a month's worth of seminars.
Wow.
It's too much.
Yeah.
15 days is a lot.
Yeah, you do. Only you one still that can do some brutal
straight is Rick. That's because he trains day and night.
It's 6 hours a day, 7 hours day a day.
Oh, so you're saying you don't train anymore, huh, Rick? Yeah, so, I'm down to 8 hours a day.
So another geek out moment. I just had another one of those little geek out moments. The universe is kind of lining up pretty cool today that we're talking about all this stuff. I was eating lunch earlier and Rapid Fire was on.
Wow.
Right in the scene in the laundry where Brandon Lee has that, he's doing all the trapping and stuff at the end. It was like, whoa, man, he died not long after that.
You know, it was funny. What was funny was I read an article in People magazine about Brandon, and they had asked him about his movie. He said, I'm an actor. And he goes, I'm an artist. I'm an actor. I do not want to follow my dad's footsteps. I don't want to get pigeonholed into martial arts movies. And then all of a sudden, he got pigeonholed into martial arts movies, except for The Crow.
I thought The Crow was awesome.
It was, but it was dark.
It was really dark. It was really dark. Rapid Fire was cool. Showdown in Little Tokyo had a couple of weird lines in it. with Dolph Lundgren, but Rapid Fire, we geeked out on that one big time, like at the movies. It was like, well, look at this, he's doing all the Guro Dan stuff. You can see all the trapping and stuff in it. And but I thought The Crow was great. It had all that grunge to it and everything. I mean, it's sad. It's unbelievably sad what happened.
He wanted to implement some of the grappling So he started to train with Sifu Larry to get some of the grappling so he could put it in the movies, and then it didn't, you know.
That guy was going to be a major star.
At the time, yeah.
Yeah, that's too bad. Now, is that the first stunt movie that Chad ever did? Was The Crow, right? Is that the first one he got called up for? Because you guys were going to go fight together in Japan, right?
Yeah, we did Baywatch.
I just put that footage up of you guys behind the scenes.
So here's how it happened. We went and auditioned. We went to a casting agent, and we gave them all our pictures. So back then, I was in the process of trying to fight. So I changed my last name to my middle name. And so I used the name Eric James instead of Eric Paulson. And I remember we got a phone call at the Inosanto Academy, and then Damon, Simo goes, "Hey, the casting agent's on the phone. And Damon, come here quick, come and talk." And then all of a sudden they go, "Yeah, so we looked at all your stuff, and we would like to hire one of your guys. He's got a good look. We like the long hair, and so we want to hire Eric James." And I remember Damon coming out of the office. He goes, "Who the hell is Eric James?" And he was looking around, and I was looking around too, like, "Oh yeah, who's that?" And then I go, "Oh, that's me." And I remember those two got so mad. They're like, "What? Your name is not Eric James?" I go, "What? Yeah, it is for acting. My middle name." So I use it. And I remember when the guy kept asking for me, and actually the name was catchy because it's two first names. And when you have two first names, like Rick, or Alan, or Bob, you become popular. So I used two first names, and the stunt coordinator kept calling me Eric James. And I was like, "Man, what do I do? Do I tell him that's really not my last name?" And I remember the disappointment on his face when I told him my real last name was Paulson. He's like, "Well, why would you use James?" And I go, "Well, because when someone calls me and leaves a message and they say they're looking for Eric James, I know it's acting. When they say I'm looking for Eric Paulson, I know it's fighting." So it's separated.
That's awesome. Pretty smart.
Yeah, so I knew which was which. And anyway, so I got hired to do Baywatch, and they said, "We need someone your size. Who do you have that's your size that can do this?" And I go, "Probably Chad. He's the same size, a little taller than me." So we got hired to do that, and then Bert Richardson thought that Chad got hired and brought me on instead of him, because Bert was getting Chad work and
doing stunts. Was he doing stunts?
Yeah. And so he kind of got mad and said, you know, "You bring in Eric and you don't bring me in, and I'm your teacher." And he didn't know it was the other way around.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was the other way around. And so I got hired, and then they brought in Chad, and then, the stunt coordinator took a big liking to Chad. And then at the time I got my SAG card off of Baywatch. He goes, "You guys both have your SAG cards." I go, "Chad does, I don't." And he goes, "Okay, I'll hire you on 10 episodes of Baywatch, and then you'll get your green card, your SAG card." And sure enough, I had to fight David Hasselhoff and run along the beach 10 different times. Rick called me from, Edinburgh, and he goes, "Hey, guess what?" I go, "What?" He goes, "You're having a fight scene with David Hasselhoff, and you're a drug smuggler."
What was funny was, I was watching the TV in Edinburgh, and for some reason in my apartment, I had a stationary bike. So I'm on a stationary bike, and I'm doing like, I think I was doing an hour. So like, I'm on a bike in my living room, I'm watching Baywatch, and Eric comes up, and I go, "Man, that's Eric." And so I pick up the phone, the landline at that time, pick up the phone, I'm on the bike, I go, "I don't think he's going to be in, but I'll call him anyway." So I call Eric, I go, "Eric, I'm watching you on the Baywatch." It was just the weirdest thing. Yeah. I'm on a stationary bike in my living room watching and be watching, and then phone in the mom's going, yeah, we just did that, yeah. So
that's so cool. Well, what's funny is none of us knew what we oh, look at that one. Is that Smoky Mountain?
That's Rick and I sparring. You can tell that Rick spent a lot of time in the sun.
I thought he was going to see in a fish and chip shop.
We were sparring there, and what happened is when the sun glanced off his back, it blinded me. No, we were sparring kickboxing, and it's so funny. Those shorts were cut off baseball pants. They were stretchy, and I thought, hey, these would be perfect for like dive shorts. So that was 1987 or 88.
Wow. Yeah, 1987 or 88. That is so cool. And so when you're doing that, you're in the ring there, you guys are going at it there. Were you already training Shooto, or you had not started that yet?
No.
So what was the predominant style there that you guys were sparring?
Kickboxing,
Thai boxing, okay. And you already knew Achan by then, right?
Yeah. And in fact, remember that year that guy got elbowed? So that was the year this guy got clipped with an elbow, and Achan goes, stop, come here. And he brought everyone over, and he's like this. This is what happens.
Oh.
This is what happens when you elbow your friend and you miss. And this guy, you can see his eyeball through his eyelid.
Oh, my God.
And it was like, I was looking at it going, man.
It's terrible.
And that was like the beginning of the Game Changer movie, which actually made me not eat meat for about a month because of all one hamburger hanging out.
Oh, man. Ugh. Nasty. Yeah. Nasty.
I think then, but even then, Coach was, it's a great photo. I love that photo. Coach was already grappling. I'd done some judo. So I remember.
That's after, how we hit it off.
Yeah. After that camp, then. I'm trying to get a timeline, but I think
90, 91.
I went to North Carolina. I went to Charlotte, I think, with Seafood Hartzell, and then Coach Erik went back to LA, and then I met him in LA about a week later, and we went to Manhattan Beach. Coach had the truck, took the mats. We went on the beach, and he was showing me, you know, some.
We were going
stuff,
back and forth with some stuff. Trading stuff.
Yeah, and then. Yeah, but no, you were much higher.
No, I wasn't. Look at this. Look at this. This guy goes, can we take a picture? I go, sure, why not? And then Alan copied that picture.
Wait, who are you fish hooking there? Is that fish hooking somebody?
Yeah, you'll see him this weekend, Alan. What's his name? He's under Lee Peacock. What's his name? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Under Lee?
I'm having trouble seeing it.
Yeah, I can't see it.
That guy's a black belt in jiu-jitsu.
And you're fishing.
You know what I'm talking about? Nader. His name's Nader. He'll be there this weekend.
Cool.
I'll send you the picture so you can show him. He'll love it.
All right.
He got kind of mad. He goes, hey, let's shoot a picture. I go, okay. He goes, do you want to put me in a submission? I go, yeah. I'll put you in a notebook. He goes, what's that?
Don't worry. He does it to everybody.
That was the year I was at Sifu Fong's, and I was assisting Guro. And Guro goes, hey, you want to teach a little shooter? I go, oh, I'll just teach a little bit. Yeah, let me use I need a partner here. Let me use Mike Makatis's cousin. And I grabbed him, and sure enough, knee on belly, and he ripped away. And it was funny because I used him three times, and every time he farted. And I think he was like, oh, I just ate. But I'm like, well, you just ate all three times. So it was becoming popular. Every time I grab him, I put knee on belly, and he would let one go. And it was funny because that's how I realized that making people laugh could be an actual full-time job. Everyone was laughing and clapping. And I was like, man, the whole room, even Guro's like, that was pretty funny.
But you're responsible for the biggest breakup I've ever seen Guro have. Because Guro can always keep it together no matter what happens. He never breaks character on when he's teaching something. He stays professional. He stays right there and focused on the drill. But Eric did a some kind of a florete or something. What was it, Eric? It was in Virginia at Pat Trey's.
So he wanted us to gunting.
Guro
so
lost it.
Left gunting, right? Gunting. Good. As he's feeding one through five or one through whatever. And all of a sudden he goes, okay, gunting. Backhand, gunting, backhand, gunting, back. And then he goes, okay, gunting. And then he goes, heaven three. Or redondo three. So I go, boom, and you're supposed to always backhand. So on this side, I guntinged, and I was in a chambered position with my stick underneath. And I go, and he goes, redondo three. And I go, and I forgot that I had to backhand first. So I go, whoa! And I go, how about that? And I go, ta-da! And he just goes, and he just drops his stick. And he goes, how did you do that? And I go, I don't know. My sticks were stuck. I rotated because my hands were in the chambered position, right? And you have to backhand, and then you go redondo three. But I didn't backhand. I just rolled.
I remember it slowly. It was a slow burn. It started building because Eric did that, and the whole room was quiet.
Yeah.
And Guro just stared at him, and yeah, he laughed a little.
Rick and Amy were shaming me. They're like, Eric, how dare you? Yeah. If you don't know the moves, why are you demoing? I'm like, shut up. I'm the demo partner.
Well, he you know, every time he stopped to bring people up for the next 20 minutes – he couldn't stop laughing. Like, and it was, like he was losing it, like crying, laughing. He could not stop thinking about it.
Pat was there. Dennis was there. I remember just looking at everybody. I go, come on, girl. Like,
and you know, Eric, he doesn't even crack a smile. He just stands there.
I was like, all right, it's not that funny anymore. And then suddenly I started getting embarrassed and I started turning all red.
It was so funny. I've just never seen Guro. Like, he couldn't even talk. He was trying to show.
For 20 minutes straight.
That's great. That's awesome.
That was so great. So, all right. So I'm going to cut it off here because you guys have been so generous spending this much time with us.
Alan, what else is going on down there?
Guro, this weekend, Sunday, I'm going to go back up to Atlanta and meet Sipu Fong. Wow. He's having the last day of his instructor camp Sunday.
Yeah, you got an action-packed week.
Yeah. It's been a good one.
So I heard you're a scuba instructor.
Yeah, about that.
That's great. Were you scared?
Did you? No, I finished that in '98. What? I haven't been active for a while, and I'm just kind of getting back into it. Yeah.
Do you ever get scared?
I've had some cave dives that I've been in that were a little scary. I had a partner that sealed out the cave. He kicked all the mud up. Couldn't see anything. And that was a moment. Wow. Yeah, you could feel the ground on your belly and you could feel the rock on your tank. It was a very tight spot.
Oh man, that's
yeah, I didn't like that at all.
No thanks. I'll pass on that one.
Wow.
Jeez.
That's scary.
Yeah. Well, thanks for bringing me down, man. Now I'm scared.
Here's a positive note. Going to Cayman Brac in December and diving for 2 days.
All right, that's cool.
That's gorgeous.
Cayman Island?
Not cold. Wow. Yeah. I'm running from the cold this year.
Do you carry a boot knife or
possible? A small knife.
So
it's not real big.
Do you know when you are in the water and a shark appears? You know what the knife's for, right? You nick your buddy and then you swim as fast as you can.
Okay.
That's like the bear story.
All you gotta do is nick him.
Just get him to leak just a little bit.
Just nick them a little bit and take off so you're not in the blood smell.
That probably works with zombies, too. Just slow him down a tad and then take off.
It works with bears, too. You know, one thing about getting chased by a bear is, you know, when you're chased by a bear, it doesn't matter if you're faster than the bear or not. It matters if you're faster than your buddy. And then you also run downhill, not uphill, downhill. They can't run as fast downhill as they can uphill. Because their front legs are shorter.
Yeah, watch the Revenant, that bear attack in that one.
Oh, yeah, that's amazing.
Did you see?
Incredible scene. Yeah.
Did you see that guy on that bicycle that was chased by that grizzly bear?
Yes.
That was scary.
Horrifying.
Those things can run like 40 miles an hour.
Yeah.
How about that tiger that ran out in the woods on that guy in Indonesia or the Philippines?
I saw that.
I didn't see that one.
He's trying to hit him with a stick.
A tiger?
Yeah. He's trying to beat him up.
Have you seen it?
No.
Oh.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Just looks at this tiger's coming up on the – you know, you'd be dead in 2 seconds if that –
oh, yeah. You're a little pink monkey snack to a tiger. You're nothing.
You know that there was a video of a family. They were arguing. And the guy stopped in the middle of the road. And the girl got out to yell because she was angry. She was yelling. She got out of the car and a tiger just came up and grabbed her and took off.
Damn.
And her husband, I've never seen that guy smile so
oh man. Awesome. Awesome. So, Coach Rick, do you have any seminars or anything coming up? Anything you want to share with everybody that you got going on lately?
The next one we go on, school's going great. Everything's going great at the school. We're not doing a lot. We had last week, we had Fionn Davison. She was.
Do you guys know who that is?
She's ADCC.
Fionn Davison.
Davis. ADCC silver medalist, fantastic player, world Nogi champion. She was great. So it was really great to have her in. Then next thing we got the CDP camp in end of November. Coach Erik coming across. That's going to be great. First time in 2 years. Coach has been.
I want to say thank you to Rick and to the judokas that you had come in to cover me last year. When I got sick last year, Rick stepped up and all those guys taught for me. They covered me, and I really, really appreciate it.
Yeah, that was a great camp because we had Ewan Burton. Ewan was a double Olympian, you know, twice bronze medalist in judo. Great player, really great player, world-class player. And he gave a really nice session. Mark Preston, my instructor, came in.
Wow.
And then George Kerr, 10th degree red belt, he came in and gave a talk.
Wow.
So it was really nice. Steve Newman taught. I taught a little bit. So it was really great. It was
when
nice
are you talk. Ever going to get those guys coming in?
Yeah, so it was really nice to have that. But this year, it's great because we've got Coach Erik back, which is fantastic.
Well, I want to say thanks to all the guys that really helped out. You know, yeah. And those guys were very fortunate to get to see all the world class there. And then next year, I'm going to fake like I'm sick again so those guys can come back in and possibly do another one.
Please do me a favor and don't do anything like that. You already had your shot at that.
Yeah. Let's not do that again.
So once is enough. Thank you, Rick.
Thank you. And that's why the guys did it, because we were talking – Coach was talking earlier on about when we went to that place and we had the session. We were saying, have you ever done anything? But those guys respect Coach so much. I mean, really respect him. These guys are very busy. And as soon as I said, they said, no problem, we'll do it.
Eric,
you know. So they were really cool, really nice they did that. But this year is going to be great because we've got the CDP. We've got a lot of people coming.
A lot of people.
For that. So then we're going to have the seminar at my school on a Saturday. I think Coach is going to stay about 4 days in Edinburgh. It's going to be great. Yeah, it's going to be cool.
Hopefully we won't get any fights at the Three Sisters Club.
No, we're not going to the Three Sisters, no.
You're not allowed to fight anymore.
But for anybody that wonders, the Three Sisters is a pub. It's not Three Sisters. It's a pub.
It's a pub.
But we're not going there.
Good place to get in fights.
We're not going there. But... So things are really good. I'm not doing a lot of seminars. I'm just gonna like try and work in my school for the next couple of months, you know, try and do that. And then, you know, see how things go from there, you know, see how things work out. But yeah, things are really good at the school, really good at home. Kids are good, you know, so I'm a happy camper. I'm happy to be here with the main man, you know, so it's wonderful.
We're going
to
go have some lunch.
We're really blessed, you know.
He cannot eat meat, so I'm going to try to get him some scampi or some fish.
Yeah.
And some vegetables.
I think Starbucks do that.
Starbucks has those egg bites.
Now you're talking.
Nectar of the gods.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Thanks so much for letting me come on.
Awesome. Thanks for giving us that nice surprise, Rick. We're getting the heavy hitters this week. So
it's great to be here.
That's so great. So I will go ahead and sign us off here. And everybody, good luck at the two CDPs that are coming up. ErikPaulson.com for all of that info. And if you have any questions, contact Alan or myself. And we'll sign it off right here. Love you guys. Thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Bob. God bless you guys.
Thank you. Thank you, Coach.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Rick.
Bye.
Bye.